The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Marshall, your guide on a curious journey through the realms of the unexplained and the unexpected. Travel is always pleasant and broadening. We can learn something from visiting new places, meeting new people. When we stay in one spot and think too much about ourselves, we tend to be withdrawn, self-centered. Well, let's expand our thinking and go along with Laura Collins on this curious journey. Curious for Laura, yes, because it's one journey she never intended or expected to take. And that's why we find her saying...
Excuse me, officer. Can you tell me where I am?
8th Avenue and 48th Street. The sign's right up there.
8th Avenue? Where?
Something wrong, miss? You all right?
I don't know. No, I'm not all right. I don't know where I am.
This is New York City. You know that, don't you?
New York City? How did I get here?
Our mystery drama, The Odyssey of Laura Collins, was written especially for the Radio Mystery Theater by Bob Juren and stars Betsy Beard. It is sponsored in part by ARM, Allergy Relief Medicine. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Sudden, unexpected events can be very difficult at times. There are people who can't cope with life after sudden bad news. They withdraw into tight little shells and shut out the world. Such a person is Laura Collins. Her mother, understandably, has been at her wit's end, coping with Laura. And at the moment, Mrs. Collins is finally seeking the help she so desperately needs.
Come in, Mrs. Collins.
Thank you, Dr. Wade.
The chair, please.
Dr. Morris told me if anyone can help Laura, you can. It's been very hard for me to admit Laura may need therapy.
Psychiatry isn't a whispered word anymore, Mrs. Collins.
Before bringing Laura to see you, I thought I could explain her problem.
Yes, of course.
Well, maybe she doesn't need therapy or very much of it. Just a touch, so to speak.
Well, there's no such thing as a touch of therapy. But we'll decide what Laura may need after we discuss the problem. Now, I'd appreciate your going into great detail, everything you can think of. I know from Dr. Morris it's a case of withdrawal, so why don't you start at the beginning? Every detail that you can remember.
The beginning. That would be her wedding day.
Mother, where's my veil?
I'm pressing it.
Already pressed.
Well, just another touch won't hurt.
And you're just too nervous to be doing nothing, I know. I'm the same way. I wish Bill and I had just eloped.
Oh, no, you don't. A girl remembers her wedding all her life. It's something a man has to put up with. But a woman spends her young years dreaming what it'll be like, and her later years remembering it.
Oh, but the waiting for 3 o'clock. It's like waiting for an execution.
Here, the veil's ready. The limo will be here in 20 minutes. Now, you just try to keep busy till
then.
Oh, I'll get it. Now, you better make sure your going away things are in order. Hello?
I have a telegram for a Miss Laura Collins.
A telegram? Oh, just a minute. Laura, it's for you. She'll be right here.
For me?
It's a telegram. I'm sure it's from your father in St. Louis, trying to make amends for not coming to the wedding.
Hello?
Laura Collins?
Yes.
Telegram, Miss Collins.
Uh-huh.
The message is as follows. Call me a heel because maybe that's what I am, but it would never work. You'll realize someday. I'm taking the coward's way out. Forget me, Laura. It's best for you. Goodbye. Love, Bill. And the sender full name is Mr. William Page.
Oh, no.
Would you like the copy delivered?
No, no. What is it?
Would you like?
Laura, what's the matter? That scream was the last sound Laura uttered for a solid month. course, the day fell apart. When the telegram was delivered, I realized what had happened.
She never spoke for a month.
Completely withdrawn.
Mm-hmm.
I tried reasoning with her. I tried making her angry. Nothing. She'd eat like a bird. And only out of sheer hunger, I suppose.
Mrs. Collins, how old is Laura?
26.
She was desperately in love with this man, too. Have had such a violent reaction.
I think she was, but...
But?
Well, Laura was insanely possessive of any attention a man gave her. She was never popular in school.
I see.
She was always shy. She couldn't project herself. She thought everyone was better than she.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not unusual.
Better looking, more talented. Oh, I tried to bolster her ego. Frankly, Laura isn't attractive or accomplished. Oh, I love her as a daughter. But I can see the difficulty she had.
You never considered therapy for her earlier?
No, I thought she'd grow out of it. Mm-hmm. Then in her 20s, well, I just kept hoping. I couldn't see how therapy would find her a husband.
No, therapy wouldn't, no. But her attitudes may have changed. But please, go on.
When she met Bill... And they announced wedding plans. Oh, I was elated.
How long had they known each other?
More than a year. It wasn't a flash in the pan. If it had been, I think she'd have gotten over it more easily.
And now she hasn't spoken for a month, you say?
Oh, that was 6 months ago. Yes, she came out of it enough to speak. I'll never forget her first words.
I think I'll kill myself today. There doesn't seem to be much else to do.
Broke the dam, at least. But it was only a trickle. She'd say odd things. She'd answer me, comment on the weather, but always in that dull, flat voice. She refused to see any of her friends. She never went back to work. She's just a zombie.
I see. And that's where we stand now.
Yes.
Well, Laura doesn't sound like a difficult case, Mrs. Collins. Of course, I have to reserve judgment until after I've examined her. Hypnosis frequently works in cases like
hypnosis.
This. The post-hypnotic suggestion of confidence can often change a person's attitude.
Well, I hope I can convince her to see you. She probably won't put up any resistance. She usually doesn't to anything.
All right, well, let's say Tuesday at 3:30. Mrs. Collins, would you come in now?
Certainly.
Laura and I have had a nice conversation. Haven't we, Laura?
Yes.
You trust me, don't you, Laura?
Yes.
Mrs. Collins, I mentioned hypnotism as a possible treatment for your daughter. I think more than ever now that it's the best route.
Oh, Dr. Wade, do what you think is best. That's why we're here.
All right. I'd like to set the first treatment for Saturday at 10. Is that all right with you, Laura?
Yes.
You heard what I plan to do?
Hypnotize me.
Yes.
All right.
Saturday at 10, then, Mrs. Collins. We'll see how and whether the first treatment has any effect. Now, Laura, you can hear me. You know who I am.
Yes.
Tell me who I am.
Dr. Wade.
And I want to help you.
Help me.
What I say will burn deep into your mind. Deep into your subconscious.
Yes.
I must think out. Think forward.
I must think out. Forward.
I must express myself. Express myself.
I must express myself.
I must come out of myself. Out of myself.
I must come out of myself. Out of myself.
When you wake up, you will repeat these words. Once a day, in a quiet room, you will repeat, express myself. Express myself. And now, Laura, at the sound of my hands clapping, you will wake up.
Oh, are you going to start the hypnosis now?
It's all over, Laura. We finished for today.
How do you feel, Laura?
All right.
Is there anything I should do, Dr. Wade?
Just be observant, Mrs. Collins. Let me know how Laura reacts.
Tom, dear, we're going home now. We'll have dinner out tonight at that favorite restaurant of ours.
All right.
These things take time, Mrs. Collins.
Mother, what time is it?
4:10. I made the dinner reservations for 6.
Oh, that's fine. I'll have time then.
Laura, you're actually looking forward to dinner out?
Yes. We haven't done it in so long.
Oh, dear heaven, I wonder...
Wonder what? Mother, what's the matter?
Nothing. You seem so much brighter.
Brighter? Than what?
We'll talk about it later. Now, why don't you have a hot bath and get ready?
Later. I have to meditate at 4:00.
At 4:00?
Yes, once a day. I chose 4:00.
Oh, yes. Of course.
I must express myself. Express myself. Express myself. I must come out of myself. Out of myself. Out of myself. Express myself. Come out of myself.
Laura, are you all right?
Hmm? Oh, Mother, come in.
I didn't want to disturb you, dear, but it's almost 5:30.
It is?
Mm-hmm.
But I've only been here a few minutes.
More than an hour, dear.
Doesn't seem like it. I'd better change. I can't wear sweater and slacks to the Pinehurst.
I do a bath for you.
Oh, I'd like that.
Now, you go soak. I'll have to get the phone.
Okay.
Hello?
Hello, Mrs. Collins. Dr. Wade here.
Oh, hello, Dr. Wade. I think I can report a good start.
Well, that's good news. A bit surprising, too. I was afraid I might have turned Laura off.
No.
I met her downtown around 4 this afternoon. She totally ignored me.
You met Laura downtown?
Yes.
Well, that's impossible, Dr. Wade. Laura never left home today. In fact, at 4:00, she was in her room meditating.
I could swear I saw her.
What was she wearing?
Well, the same outfit she had on in the office this morning. White sweater and slacks. Green, I think. Maybe it wasn't Laura. I could have been mistaken. I didn't actually meet her. I saw her through the crowd at Wilson's dime store. I tried to get her attention. It must have been someone else.
It must have been.
Well, I'm glad to hear she followed the post-hypnotic suggestion. You say she's meditating.
Oh, she's finished now. She's taking a bath and... actually looking forward to going out to dinner.
Wonderful. Well, I'll see her again next Saturday, same time.
Thank you, Doctor.
Goodbye, Mrs. Collins.
Goodbye. I wonder... No, she couldn't have. Laura?
Yes?
Laura, you didn't go downtown today, did you? When you told me you were going to be in your room?
Downtown? Of course not. Why would I do that?
It must have been someone else. Dr. Wade only met Laura early this morning. He could easily mistake some other girl in a white sweater and green slacks for Laura across a crowded floor. When Dr. Wade thought he saw her, Laura was in her room expressing herself. After all, we can't be in two places at once, can we? Before we jump to conclusions, let's see what happens when I return shortly with Act Two. Self-expression is an important human characteristic. The human spirit needs the release self-expression provides. There's expression in writing, music, art, baking a perfect cake, or repairing an automobile. Whenever we do what we do best, we are expressing our inner selves. A sudden shock kept Laura Collins from being herself, caused her to withdraw. But hopefully with the help of Dr. Wade and a bit of hypnotism, Laura is beginning to come out of her shell.
And you're meditating regularly, Laura?
Yes, every day.
And I have such curious dreams sometimes.
Dreams?
Yes. One afternoon while I was meditating, I dreamed I was in a beautiful field of flowers. I could actually smell them and touch them. And another day, I was on a boat floating down a river. I dragged my hand in the water. And you know what? When I woke up, my hand was wet. It was just perspiration, I guess.
You always have these dreams when you meditate?
No, not always. But they're always nice.
Uh-huh. Good. Well, I want you to keep it up. That's what's getting you out of yourself.
I must express myself.
Express yourself.
I must come out of myself.
Out of yourself.
Out of myself. Out of myself. Out of myself.
Laura? Laura, it's almost time for dinner. Laura? Laura!
Oh, good heavens! She's on the floor. What is it? Laura, please, answer me. Oh, dear heavens. She's breathing. Oh, Laura. Laura.
Thank heaven you're there. It's Mrs. Collins. Something's happened to Laura.
I don't know. I went to call her for dinner, and she was on the floor, unconscious. Yes, she was. I don't know. I was too upset to look. Can you come right away? Thank you.
Laura. Laura.
It's as if she...
No, she's not. She's comatose. And there's hardly a pulse. Shallow breathing. We've got to get her to a hospital immediately. Where's the phone?
Excuse me, officer. Can you tell me where I am?
Yes, miss. This is 8th Avenue and 48th Street. Signs right up there.
8th Avenue? Where?
Something wrong, miss? You all right?
I don't know. No, I'm not all right. I don't know where I am.
Well, this is New York City. You know that, don't you?
New York City? How did I get here?
Are you lost?
But I can't be in New York City. My home's in Brookville.
Where's that?
Near Cleveland, Ohio.
Well, you must know how you got here. Bus, train, plane?
I'm just here. I don't know how I got here.
I think you need some help, miss. I'll call for a squad car. All right, Miss Collins, we're going to call your mother. There isn't a missing person bulletin on you. When we talk with her, maybe she can clear this up.
Yes.
Here, you dial your home.
All right.
We'll take care of you until someone can come for you. You still don't have any idea how you got to New York, huh?
No, none. It's ringing.
Hello?
Hello, Mother. It's me, Laura. I'm in New York.
Who is there?
It's me, Laura. I don't know what happened.
Young woman, I don't know who you are or what you want.
Mother?
What do you mean, Mother? You're not my daughter. And I'm hanging up right now.
Mother, please.
Here, wait a minute. Let me. Mrs. Collins. Mrs. Collins.
This is Mrs. Collins. And who are you? What are you people doing to me?
Mrs. Collins, you do have a daughter named Laura.
Yes. Now, who is this?
I'm Officer Edwards, New York City Police.
Police?
Your daughter is here, Mrs. Collins, here with us in New York. Now, she doesn't know how she got here.
Officer, please. There's some awful mistake. My daughter Laura is in the hospital at this moment in a coma, wired to a life support system.
I don't know
who that girl is you have there, but it is not my daughter. How did you get my name and phone number?
The girl dialed it herself.
Well, it is totally a mistake. My daughter is in a coma in Brookville Hospital, and I ought to know. I just left her. Whoever that young woman is, she is not my daughter, and I do not want to talk to her. Good night, officer.
Where is she? She hung up.
She wouldn't believe me.
She says her daughter's in Brookfield Hospital in a coma. Maybe you dialed the wrong number. You got the wrong woman.
I know my mother's voice. That was her.
Well, are there any other Laura Collinses in Brookfield?
No, I'm the only one.
Yes. Well, now, look, miss, we'll do some more investigating, but you're exhausted. We're going to take you to a hospital for the night.
Oh, no.
Just to rest, to get an examination. By tomorrow or the next day, maybe we can clear this all up.
What happened to me? My own mother. What could she mean? I'm in the Brookville hospital.
Now, try to relax, miss. We'll take care of you. There's nothing to worry about. You're not under arrest. I just want to help you get home. Excuse me. Hello. Dr. Henry. Tony Edwards, 14th Precinct. I'd like to bring a young girl in tonight for observation. No. Not high on anything. Lost. Confused. She has herself mixed up with someone else. Hey, where did she go? The girl was right here a second ago. She's gone.
Hey, lady. Want to tell me what's wrong? Hey, don't mind if I share the bench, then? Park's kind of crowded this evening. Oh, it's too nice an evening for tears.
I'm sorry.
Oh, no need to apologize.
I just don't know what to do. I'm so frightened. Confused.
Well, aren't we all these days?
I don't know how I got here. My mother says I'm in the hospital and I have no money and I've never been to New York before and the police want to put me...
Hey, whoa, back.
Oh, please. Maybe you can help me.
Look, what's your name?
Laura Collins.
I'm Jerry Morphy. I know a great little cafe where they have the best cannoli on the west side. What do you say we solve your problem over some hot coffee and chilled cannoli?
Okay. You don't believe a word of it. The police didn't either.
No, it's not that I don't believe you, Laura. You just got some of your facts confused.
But here I am with you, and the last thing I remember was sitting in that police station. And before that, I was in my room in Brookville.
You had one hell of a blackout.
Blackout?
Mm-hmm.
But even if I did, how did I get the money to get to New York? Brookville's near Cleveland. I have no recollection of traveling at all. And here I am with no money or luggage.
When you called your mother, you said she told you her daughter was in the hospital?
That's what she told the policeman. Well, Jerry, I think I'm losing my mind. I must be.
Now, wait a minute.
I've been under the care of an analyst. It goes back to losing a boy I knew. I thought this doctor was helping me.
Look, Laura... The only thing we can do tonight is get you settled. I live with my mother on 116th Street. She's a professor at Columbia. I'm a med student there. She'll understand. Okay? Now you come home with me.
Oh, I...
You have no other place to go.
Well, that's the truth. Oh, Jerry. How could anyone be so kind?
Is she sleeping?
I think so.
Jerry, I agree we ought to help the girl, but the place for her is in a hospital. She's obviously suffering from amnesia or delusions. You, of all people, ought to recognize it.
No, I don't think it's that. She knows who she is, but she doesn't know how she got here. She says when she called home from the police station, her mother said her daughter was in a coma in the hospital.
She told you that?
Yes.
Jerry, there is something wrong with the girl. She needs professional help. Let her stay the night. First thing in the morning, have the police try to find out who she is and locate her family.
Hi. Sleep well?
I didn't sleep at all. I wasn't even a bit tired. I'm sorry you gave up your bed.
Oh, it's okay. Mother's gone to an 8:00 class. Laura, I want to call your mother this morning. We've got to talk to her again.
If she doesn't hang up on us, like she did with the policeman.
She won't. But you'd better eat something first.
I'm not a bit hungry. I should be. I haven't had anything to eat since... Well, I don't know. But I'm not hungry at all or tired. Isn't that strange?
Laura, let's not wait. There's the phone. Dial your home and be very careful with the number. No mistakes now.
All right.
And then, give the phone to me.
Hello?
Mrs. Ellen Collins?
Yes?
Mrs. Collins, please hear me out. Don't hang up.
Who is this?
My name's Jerry Marfay. I'm a medical student at Columbia University in New York City.
Not this again.
Mrs. Collins, you do live at 181 Elm Street and have a daughter named Laura.
Yes.
And your daughter is in the hospital there in Brookville?
How do you know this? Why are you calling me?
Is your daughter in a coma?
Yes. Yes.
She never left home then? She hasn't been missing?
Of course not. I rode in the ambulance with her myself. But why are you...
You'd recognize Laura's voice, of course.
Of course.
Go ahead, Laura.
Mother, it's me, Laura. I'm in New York, but I don't...
Will you stop it? Whoever you are, will you stop it?
Mother! Why doesn't she believe me? What's happening to me?
Laura. Laura. come in, Mrs. Collins.
No change?
No change.
Dr. Wade, I must talk to you.
Yes, certainly. Step outside. Why are you shaking?
Well, I am so upset, Dr. Wade. It's the phone calls. Last night, again this morning.
What phone calls?
From people in New York City telling me Laura is there. And some horrible girl gets on the phone and impersonates...
Wait a minute, Mrs. Collins. Slower, please. What people from New York City?
I don't know. Last night, a woman phoned and said she was Laura. Then a man who called himself a policeman got on and said Laura was there with him.
And this morning?
It was the same girl, but a different man. He knew my address. He knows Laura's in the hospital. And then this woman got on and called me Mother.
What else? What else did they say?
I hung up on them.
Laura is seen in New York. And yet we know that in that room...
It's driving me out of my mind.
Mrs. Collins, did by any chance this man tell you his name?
Oh, he said it, but I don't remember it.
Now,
I was too upset.
Think. Any clue. It's important.
Oh, dear. He said something like Parfait or Harvey. I'm not sure.
I've got to locate him. Anything else?
Well, he said he was a med student at Columbia. Yes. Yes, it's coming back now.
Good.
And I think his first name was... Jerry.
Good. It's a start. Columbia and a med student. Maybe he's guessed it.
What are you talking about? Does he have a connection with Laura?
Possibly a vital one. I've got to reach him immediately. Laura's life depends on it.
Have you guessed it? What's happened to Laura? She lies in a coma in Ohio, and yet... apparently has turned up in New York City, befriended by a young med student named Jerry Marfay. We'll find out what danger Laura is in and what happens to her next when I return shortly with Act 3. Psychiatrist Dr. Wade seems to have diagnosed a curious link between the people in New York who are calling Mrs. Collins, the girl who claims to be Laura, and Laura herself, who lies in a hospital bed in Brookville. Dr. Wade has taken Mrs. Collins back to his office to prepare her for something she'll find impossible to believe.
Astral projection?
Mind travel. I'm convinced the girl in New York may be Laura's astral self.
But how can...
Parapsychologists have dozens of documented cases where people asleep or in shock have actually appeared hundreds, even thousands of miles away.
What?
Now, as far as believing, well, I'm on the fence myself. But it's worth pursuing in Laura's case.
What can you do?
First, pray that my secretary can locate this... Parfait or Harvey or whatever through the university. She's on it right now. When we reach him, I've got to try to convince him of my theory.
This is a nightmare.
The life support system will keep Laura's body alive until, hopefully, her astral self returns.
I don't want to hear any more, please.
I know it seems grotesque to you, Mrs. Collins. There is a strong chance that the astral substance will return of its own accord.
You really believe in this? You believe this is what happened to Laura?
Well, it explains those phone calls and Laura's condition. I was up half the night trying to figure out what happened to her. Why should she suddenly fall into a coma? There's no physical illness. I reviewed my treatment, the hypnosis, the suggestion to Laura to get out of herself, to express herself.
And you're saying that this is what she has done, literally?
Yes. Oh. And if I can reach this student in New York who calls you, I can verify it.
But what's going to happen to Laura?
Well, ordinarily, the astral self returns to the body in a brief span of time. But Laura's gone so far and for so long, I don't know.
Well, then, there's the chance that Laura may never come back if her, whatever you call it, just doesn't come back.
I have to be honest with you, Mrs. Collins. Yes, there is that possibility. Hello?
Jerry, it's Mother. What are you doing home? I thought you'd be in class.
I didn't want to leave Laura. We called her mother and got the same response. Laura's pretty upset.
Now listen, I don't know what this means, but the administration office was looking for you. They gave me this message.
Now what is it?
They had a call from a Dr. Wade, a psychiatrist. He is desperately trying to find a medical student at Columbia named Parfait or Harvey. The name was close. There's no student named Parfait or Harvey.
I don't know what he'd want with me, whoever he is.
They gave me his number if you want to satisfy your curiosity and mine. He's calling from Brookville, Ohio.
Hello, Dr. Wade. I'm Jerry Marfay in New York.
Jerry, you're the med student who called Mrs. Collins this morning?
That's right. Say, what's going on? Why does she hang up on Laura like that?
Jerry, now listen carefully. Is Laura with you now?
Yes, she's right here. She was so relieved when I told her you were trying to reach us.
Ask him if I can talk to Mother.
Tell me, what does she look like?
Look like? Well, short, blonde hair, cute nose.
Anything unusual about her?
No, the only thing unusual is the way her mother's been acting. Doesn't she want Laura home?
Let me speak to her.
He wants to talk to you.
Oh, hello, Dr. Wade.
Laura, how do you feel?
I want to come home. What's happened, Dr. Wade? How did I get here? And what's Mother talking about?
Laura, I'll explain things when you get home. Now, you stay with Jerry and do just as he tells you, all right? He's going to bring you home. Now, remember, Laura, it's very important. Stay with that young man.
I will.
Put Jerry back on, will you? And relax, Laura. Everything's going to be all right.
Okay. He wants you again.
Hello?
Jerry, now listen to me carefully. That most certainly is Laura Collins. Now, try to understand what I'm going to say. And whatever you do, don't tell Laura.
What is all this?
Jerry, you've got to be very careful with Laura. You must cooperate with me. That girl's life depends on it.
Okay, but what...
The girl with you is Laura Collins' astral self.
Her what?
I don't know how much you know about parapsychology, but please go along with me. You mustn't do anything to disturb her. That girl with you is actually a projection of Laura's mind.
What's he saying?
He's not making sense.
Whether you believe this or not, please try to do as I say. We've got to get her back to Brookville.
Well, that's what she's been wanting all along.
Well, it's getting dangerous. Laura's astral self has been out of her body for more than 24 hours now. And the distance is extreme. Apparently, it can't find the way back. And the longer it stays apart from Laura's body, the less chance it has of getting there. The invisible cord that holds the astral self to the body weakens.
If you say so.
Well, I don't blame you for not believing me, but will you help me?
Sure. To help Laura.
Now, there is a chance that you may be able to bring her back. That is, she trusts you and she'll go with you.
Yes?
Whatever you do, let her out of your sight. Stay with her and fly to Cleveland on the very next flight you can get.
Oh, Dr. Wade.
Mrs. Collins, I located that chap in New York. I talked to Laura.
Huh? You talked with her?
Yes.
I look at her lying there, still as death, and you tell me you talked to her.
She's on her way back.
How soon will we be there?
We ought to be landing in a few minutes.
Oh, you've been so kind to me, Jerry. I could have flown back alone, but I'm glad you came with me.
I couldn't let you come alone.
I wonder if I'll ever find out how I got to New York. I just can't understand it.
Well, don't think about that. You're almost home now.
I was so lucky to meet you. I don't know what might have happened to me.
A lot might have already, it seems.
Jerry, I'm beginning to feel funny.
What, funny?
Jerry, I...
What's the matter?
I feel so strange all of a sudden. So peculiar.
It's the plane, probably. It's been bumpy.
No. No, I have this funny tugging feeling.
Tugging?
Mm-hmm. As though I were being pulled. I feel kind of faint.
Try to relax. We'll be down soon.
It's like I was being drawn away. Pulled away.
Laura.
Jerry, what's happening? What's happening to me?
Laura. Good Lord. She's gone. Excuse me. Are you Dr. Wade?
Yes, Jerry. I've been watching for Laura.
She's gone.
Gone?
I couldn't believe it. We were almost coming in for the landing. Laura said that she felt she was being pulled away, and she just vanished. Right next to me, she vanished.
So close, so close.
I don't know what I did.
It's not your fault. Come on, we've got to get to the hospital.
Laura, did you... Mother!
Oh, dear God. Oh. Thank you.
Mother.
Laura.
Mother, where am I?
Oh, my dear girl.
Why am I in this room? What is this room?
You're in the hospital, dear.
Hospital? You said on the phone I was in the hospital. I was in New York.
You've been in a coma since yesterday.
A coma?
I'll have to call the nurse.
No, no. Please wait. I wasn't in New York.
You've been here all the time.
Then I dreamed. It was a dream. New York and Jerry.
Mrs. Collins.
She's awake.
She's back.
Laura.
Dr. Wade. Mother says I was in a coma.
How do you feel?
Tired. Isn't that funny? I'm tired after sleeping for 2 days. I had the strangest dream. It was so real. I met such a nice young man. Oh, he was so good to me. I'm sorry. It was just a dream.
Jerry.
It's all right for me to come in?
Jerry. You are Jerry.
Hello, Laura.
I remember now. You brought me home on the plane. But... I don't understand. I just don't understand at all.
Laura, you've had an out-of-body experience, and a very unusual one. Your body was here in the hospital, but you projected yourself mentally.
An out-of-body experience? I was here, and I was in New York. That's why Mother didn't believe me when I called.
How could I?
And that's why I wasn't hungry or tired or anything.
That's right.
And I met you, Jerry.
You sure did.
Oh, that was the nicest part. You were so good to me.
I hope maybe when you're okay and out of the hospital, you'll come back to New York. I could really show you the city.
I'd like that. But when I do, I'll try to come in person.
What a convenient way to travel, wouldn't you say?
No train or plane reservations, no waiting for luggage. But of course, it's not as simple as it sounds. Very few people really have this psychic experience of mind travel or astral projection. And your chances of going on vacation while your body stays behind are pretty slim indeed. I'll have another thought on the subject when I return shortly. It's curious what the mind can do. It can take us to unknown worlds. It can lift us up to experience the heights of excitement. With our mind's eye, we can see beyond the everyday humdrum of life and let our imaginations take us to the ends of the universe and beyond. I hope you'll have your mind's eye and your imagination ready when we meet again for another tale on Mystery Theater. Our cast included Betsy Beard, Don Scardino, E.B. Juster, and Cort Benson. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.